All right, guys, so good morning, everyone. We are going to start our topic called Kafka. Okay, let's understand what exactly a Kafka is. Before you understand this Kafka, we have to understand some terms like messaging and queue. Okay, so in a real time, you will see a lot of use cases wherein the data is constantly flowing from one source to the destination. Let's take an example. Okay, take an example. Let's say you have a server, you have a web server, and this web server is constantly writing the data into a file. Let's say a log file. Let's say log. I'll say report.log, some log file, right? So web server is constantly writing the data to a log file. Now, what would be the frequency at which the data would be written? It would be on milliseconds, right? Every milliseconds, the web server would be producing a lot of messages, and those messages would be written in the report.log file. Now, if you see, this is called as your streaming, right? So like the data is flowing. The data is flowing from source to your destination. This is your source and it's your destination, right? And this is basically called as a stream. The data is getting streamed from source to the destination. Okay. Now messaging means what? Passing a message, right? So if you see, my web server is passing a message to my report.log every milliseconds, every seconds, and they are captured and they are stored in that log file. It's not it. Now let's take another example. So when I was, going through an article from Hortonworks earlier in their website, they were talking about one such use case where they were using big data, and that was actually the vehicle movement system. Assume that you have a packers and movers company, right? Assume that you have a packers and mover companies, or we can take one more better example, say IRCTC, right? So say you have IRCTC rails, right? Now see, there are so many rails, there are so many, this locomotive, we call it locomotive, right? So there are so many trains that goes from one place to another place, right? At different time of the day, it's not it. So say you have, let's say you have 2000 trains that operates across India, right? One train goes from Secunderabad to Bangalore, the other train maybe from Mumbai to Goa, the other train from Secunderabad to Ruxol, and so on, right? So the movement of the trains are crazy like anything. Now, if I say, let me install one simple device in all these trains, and that device would always send me some information about this train. For example, maybe the train ID, I'll say train number, latitude, longitude, okay, and temperature. See, in all these locomotives, in all these trains, you have installed that small device, right? A IoT kind of device. And this device is actually constantly sending the train number, which is fixed, the latitude and longitude of the place, which will vary based on various times, temperature, which would again vary based on different times, right? And let's say all these details are being sent to a server. All these details are constantly sent to a server. Okay. And let's say these details are sent every 30 seconds. Every 30 seconds, right? Every 30 seconds, all the possible trains in India is sending the data to a centralized server, right? And in this server, you have some processing that can help you to identify where exactly that train is right now. If you see, you have a service called Know the Live Running Status of a Train. How do they know it? By doing something like this. Not, may not be exactly like this, but by doing something similar to this. It's not it. So if you see this process, in this process, the data is again flowing, right? From source to destination. Source are your locomotives. In this case, the source are moving source, is not it? moving source. The source are constantly moving, and the server is a centralized server where the data is continuously getting stored. Okay, now you can basically build a dashboard around it, or you can do some analysis on it, whatever, right? So it can be consumed by various different consumers. Now I hope you understood what is the meaning of messaging. Messaging means sending the data, right? Like a data that you send from one source to the destinations are basically messages, right? Any text that you send from source to destinations are your message. You may send me a WhatsApp chat message, that is a message. You may send me a Facebook message, that's also a message. You're sending some piece of information from source to destination, that is also a message. Okay, we understood this. Now the streaming, what is streaming, guys? Streaming means what? The movement of data from one source to the destination, right? So the data is moving from your trains to the server, and we call it a streaming. Done. Next. Now I have a big question here. If all these 2000 trains are sending data, let's say every 30 seconds to my server, will my server be able to handle all this load? See, all this data is coming to you, right? At 30 seconds together here and there, right? And in real time, you may have more than 2000 trains. We just have to Google it out, right? So if all these trains are sending the data to the server, then most likely the server may not be able to handle all the requests, probably. Okay, let's take another example. If you remember way back in a few years ago, right, getting a Tatkal ticket, right, was a nightmare in India. The reason was every day at 10 o'clock, a lot of people wants to book a ticket from X place to Y place, and the total number of users are so much that the Tatkal ticket is over within no time, right? Not even in a minute. I have personally experienced that, like everything is done. It is on the payment page, right? And then the payment is processing. And at the end of the day, it says, sorry, we could not serve the request, and it's done. And by the time you again come back, you will see that the seats are already booked, right? There is no more seats available. And that was one of the biggest problem we were always facing, right? The reason could be because the systems were not designed by looking at this scale, right? Now, what I'm trying to tell you is, if you have a server and you do a lot of, you give a lot of requests to that server, there would be a threshold of each of the servers, okay? All the servers would have a threshold. Beyond that, the server would not be able to serve your request. So what happens, you know, every server by default will have some sort of queuing mechanism, a default queuing mechanism, which says at any given time, I can handle, say, 100 requests. Okay. Now, if I get 200 requests, then those 200 requests will have to wait. Like we'll have to wait, and this 100 requests would be processed. Okay. Now again, after some more time, you may get one more 100 requests. So now you have already 200 requests, and there would be a time where the server would not be able to serve your request at all. You might have noticed that sometime when you are using some service, it keeps rotating. The page keeps rotating no matter how fast your internet is, and at the end of the day, it says timeout error, probably, right? One such reason of the timeout error could be your request was not served by the server because of the time delay, because it's busy processing some other request. Okay. And this is one of the biggest problem in any traditional system. Okay. Now, as I said, every server might come up with a default queue, and that default queue would be very minimal capacity. You cannot really make it serve millions of requests. Of course not. Okay. That is where you have a concept of Kafka. And Kafka is basically a distributed messaging system. Okay. Kafka is basically a distributed messaging system. Let's understand with one more example. So suppose you went to a railway counter. right, to book a ticket, assuming that we are not using an online approach. Let's say you went to a railway counter to book a ticket physically, right? When you go there, you'll see a lot of people are standing in a queue. It's not it. And when you go, you'll have to just join the queue and wait for your turn, right? Now, what is the capacity of that queue, guys? How long can that queue go? That queue has a limit, is not it? Like, see, you start from the counter and it will keep increasing, it will keep increasing. And then you will happen to see people are coming out of the, you know, railway station probably, right? And then you will happen to see people have now come down to the streets, right? Which is not really possible, right? So what I'm trying to tell you is, in any messaging platform where you have a lot of messages to be processed, right, it is possible that the total number of messages is so big that it cannot be stored in a small queues, right? And that is the reason why what you would need there is a distributed queue. Okay, so let's try to visualize this. Assume this is your ticket counter, right? And here you are on a queue. You are on a queue, right? And everyone will come in this queue. Their request will be served, and they will go. They leave the queue. The next guy will again come to the queue, go to the counter. It will its request would be processed and it would be again out of the queue and so on, right? Now, as I said, on any typical busy day, you may see the queues are increasing like anything, okay? And let's say this is a railway station ticket counter and this is a roll. And it is possible that you have started crossing the road. Where will this guy will go and sit, right? So this is a typical problem in any messaging system in the real world, okay? If you are not using a good messaging system, then you'll end up doing something like this, right? Instead of that, can we create something called a waiting hall? Can we create something called a waiting hall, wherein we will say all the people who wants the ticket, they should come here and they should sit here. We'll give them chairs and we'll say, you guys can sit here. And we have already given your token number and don't leave the seat. When turn comes, you go and get your request served, right? And we'll get rid of this whole queuing system altogether. So what will happen is the ticket counter will always look empty, right? And at the same time, all the people are waiting in a waiting hall, right? And at the right moment, when my turn comes, I'll just go to the ticket counter and get my ticket served, right? And get my ticket booked, and then I'll come out on this, right? Now this looks a little better. It's not it. Instead of you waiting and then crossing the road, this looks much more better. What if I have more people? Maybe I have another waiting hall. Okay, so I have a lot of waiting halls where people can wait, they can sit, and then we will serve them, and then they'll go, right? So if you look into this diagram, these are all your queue. These are all your queue. And this is where Kafka is coming into the picture. So Kafka can basically help you creating a queue like this, where the message would stay till it is not solved, right? And that's the advantage of using Kafka. So Kafka is basically a distributed messaging system, as well as it is basically a distributed queue. Okay, you can say distributed messaging system, or you can also say distributed queue. So what does it do? It basically helps you to store the data in a queue till it is not solved, right? And the biggest advantage is your counter, you know, will not have to worry by looking into the queue, right? So if you see the queue, the ticket counter guy will be, you know, he will be depressed by looking into the total number of people present there, right? I remember in 2012 when I applied for a job at Capgemini, right? It was a massive drive after a long time, and I had only 2 years of experience that time, right? And let me tell you, the line was so big that we were literally standing outside of the campus. Almost the whole queue was around 1 kilometer, to be very honest. Okay, I went there at 10 o'clock 10 o'clock. I gave my first written exam at 7 p.m. The queue was so big, right? And that's where your Kafka comes into the picture. Kafka says, hey, you come to us, we'll take care of you. And whenever required, we'll send you to the counter so that your request can be solved. Okay. So this is a introduction to Apache Kafka. So I hope you understood what exactly Apache Kafka can do. Apache Kafka can be used whenever there is a requirement that the source systems are producing too many messages, then your counter guy can handle, right? In that case, we'll say, okay, let us introduce a queue. Let all the messages come to the queue. And what we'll do is we'll serve them one by one. Okay. Now, let's say I started a software company. I have my own, I started my product based company. And let's say we work on a product. Okay. Now, initially, what happens, you know, you basically end up with two systems. Okay. One is your web, and another one is your database. Right. Let's take the example of online learning center.in. Okay. If you ask me what is online learning center.in, I would say a website and with a database. That's not it. Whenever somebody registers for our course, the entry would be made in the database, right? Whenever I assign a course to you, those details would be stored in the database, right? And we have all our business logic in our web, right? In our web server. We have written some code that can help you to log in, that can help you to go to your courses, that can help you to consume the course. It's not it. But if you see, what is OLC? OLC is nothing but web server plus database. That's it. Nothing more than that. Okay. Now, in this case, the interaction is very straightforward. Like I have just a database and I have a website. Done. Nothing more than that. Okay. In these cases, you may not see a, you know, like real utility of a queue because it's very, very simple system, right? But when you talk about any typical, you know, like if you talk about any typical software, product-based companies or any customers, the systems would not be so easy. Okay, the system would be something like this. I have a mainframe system. Okay, I have Oracle database. I have SAP. Okay, I have some network file system, probably a lot of stuff, and all these are storing some data, right? They have the data within themselves. And then I'll have a Tableau, which will do some reporting. I have written some custom Scala code, which would again process some data. We have a web UI, some website, some web pages, which can again fetch the data. And let's say we have some REST API that consumes some data. Okay, so like let's say we have four storage and we have four processing layer or visualizing layer, we call it. Okay, and I don't know what would be the probability here, right? So maybe a Tableau, like we have created a Tableau which will say I'll bring the data from mainframe, I'll also bring the data from Oracle, I'll also bring the data from SAP, and I'll also bring some data from NFS, and I'll start, know, like using all this data to create a beautiful dashboard for you, for the customers, right? Done. The Scala code may say, hey, I want to process something wherein I'll read the data from mainframe, from Oracle, from SAP, from NFS. Okay. The web UI may say, hey, I also would like to do something very similar. I'll get the data from all these places. I'll do some processing and I'll display it on the web. The UI. Okay. The REST API may say, okay, I have to send some data to the customers. I'll get the data from here, get the data from here, get the data from here, get the data from here. And I'll do this. Right. Now, do you see a very complicated, engineering has been done here? Right. Think about this. Let's assume these are actually your electronic devices and you're just trying to get a connection. Right. You'll end up with a lot of wires, is not it? So, see how complicated you have created the systems. Right. This is where the traditional system would look like. And it was like this once upon a time, right? Now, this is very hard to even, work on. It's not it. And this It's like you're tightly coupling everything, right? You're tightly coupling everything, and this is the biggest problem here. Okay. And now then came the role of Kafka and all distributed messaging system, which says, hey, are you stupid to do all these things? Why are you doing it even? Right? Let's try to do the same problem. Let's try to solve the same problem using some other technique. And the technique was very simple. It said, okay, you have mainframe, you have Oracle, you have SAP, you have NFS, right? And of course, you have Tableau, you have Scala code, you have Web UI, and you have REST API, those four boxes. And it said, let me have a layer here. I'll call it Kafka. Let me have a layer here and I'll call it a Kafka. You guys write here. You guys write here and you guys read from here. Done. That's all. So your complicated networking has been simplified, right? So all the messages, whatever you want to send it to some third party or some other system, write it into your Kafka and let that third party, right, or the external system read the data from Kafka. And this is what makes Kafka very, very powerful, right? So Kafka can help you to store the data, right? Store the data in a single entity, right? You are not sure where exactly it is. We'll come across that. And then it allows the other system to read the data from it. Okay. Now, at this stage, if you see, there are four pieces. These are the four units or system which are actually writing the data into a Kafka. And you call it producers because they are producing messages. Okay, you call them producers. Anybody who is actually writing the data to a Kafka are called as producers. Okay. And the systems which are actually reading the data from your Kafka are called as consumers. Because they are consuming the data from your Kafka servers, right? So you need to understand this terminology, producer, consumer. And this guy whom we are calling Kafka are called as server. You can call it Kafka server or you can call it a broker. You can call it a broker because it acts as a middleman, right? So it acts as a middleman which stores the data which is pushed by the producers and it gives the data to the consumer on request. So this guy is also called as broker or you can call it a Kafka server or you can call it just a server or you can call it Kafka. Okay. The most frequently used term is broker. So we will call producer, we'll call consumer and we'll call a broker. Right now, if we have to implement this, what you need to do is whenever you feel you are going to write the data to these systems, right? See here, mainframe and Tableau. So maybe there is some sort of plugin, right, which actually writes the data to a Tableau. It's possible that the Tableau might have a plugin which can fetch the data from mainframe directly, probably, right? But still, you are doing the same thing. Still, you are doing the same thing, right? For example, I may say I've developed a Scala code which uses some connectivity, or maybe we have built some driver which can directly read the data from Oracle database. We've all done that, right? So we have seen how can you read the data from Oracle. We've all done that, right? So they are basically the typical approach. They are basically the typical approach. They are not a distributed approach. Okay. If you want to do something distributed, then what you should do is you should basically introduce a Kafka in the middle and let all the messages go to the Kafka only, right? So the producer would have no clue about the consumers, okay? It's not the producer's business. The producer says, hey, I'm producing the data, I'm pushing it to the Kafka, and I really don't care who is going to read it. It's now the consumer. The consumer says, hey, I have to read the data, and I want to read the data probably from this guy, and from this guy, but not from this guy. So you can choose that from which system you want to read the data, from which system you don't want to read the data. You can choose that in the consumer phase. But from the producer phase, the producer would simply produce the data and store it in the Kafka. Okay. Now let's go back to our same example of locomotive, right? The train data. Every train has that, you know, that unique device. That device would be sending the data, right? Now that data should be captured by server something, and that should be written to a Kafka system, right? So every time, every, let's say 30 seconds or 1 minute, the data is getting generated from every train, right? And those data might go to the server probably. From the server, it would be written to a Kafka system, right? And let the data be present in the Kafka system, and we will do the consumption later. We will not process, because processing will take a lot of time, right? So all we want to do is read the data, throw it to Kafka, read the data, throw it to Kafka, read the data, throw it to the Kafka, right? And later what we'll do, we will start consuming the data from Kafka. And we'll see that, we'll try to visualize that using the code snippet as we move on with the program, okay? So let's move on. So we have now a screen set here. Let's go through this document so that you don't miss anything out here, right? So what is the messaging? As I said, assume you have just one server and many clients are giving requests to that server. The server may be able to handle, say, 10 requests per second, and all clients altogether are sending 20 requests per second. In that case, the server will be able to just manage 10 requests, and the remaining 10 requests would go unserved, right? Some example of the messaging systems are like JMS, you have TIBCO, you have RabbitMQ, and so on. So you have a lot of, you know, like messaging systems. Like earlier, people were using TIBCO, people were using RabbitMQ, people were using JMS as well. Today also, people are using those, but then it depends on the scale. If you are looking for, if you have a requirement to process a large volume of data, then of course, Kafka should be a choice. Okay, next. What is streaming? We also talked about that. Streaming is simply a data flow from source to a destination, right? For example, a web server writing log to a log file every millisecond, okay? A lot of Facebook user chat data continuously flowing from one source to destination. Think about it. Anytime within the Facebook system, so many people are sending so many requests to their friends or talking to their friends, right? A lot of data is flowing from source to the destination, of course, right? Next, a lot of money transaction happening in the real time from source to the destination bank, right? While you are sleeping, many people are doing transactions, isn't it? And that's also a real time data movement from here to there. Now, there are quite many popular streaming technologies that includes Flume, Storm, Kafka, and Spark streaming, okay? And if you see, Flume are used for faster streaming processing where delivery may not be 100%. Okay, the delivery may not be 100%. And it is okay to use Flume when you are okay to miss some message. And Flume can do streaming only. Storm are used for live analytics where we can run the algorithm to each message that we receive from the source. And it is a real-time processing engine. Again, Kafka can do streaming as well as messaging. So messaging is what? Storing the message. And streaming means the real-time streaming. So Kafka has the potentiality of doing both streaming as well as the messaging. And it is a messaging broker, which is a real-time injecting tool. And you have one more concept called Kafka streaming. I did not write anything about it because we will learn about this in great detail in our Spark lessons. Okay. All right. So let's have a look about this Apache Kafka. Who started this? When was that introduced? Okay. Now, interestingly, Kafka was started at LinkedIn. People at LinkedIn, they started this tool called LinkedIn. Okay. They created this tool called Kafka. And it became open source Apache project in 2011. There are a few people who are the top contributors, like Jun Rao, Jay Krebs, and Neha Narkhede. Okay. They were the main developers who actually started this project called Apache Kafka. And later they created their own company called Confluent, which is again, you know, very similar to Kafka. And they are like basically the paid service, of course. The component is named Kafka after the author Franz Kafka, because it is a system optimized for writing. This guy, Franz Kafka, was a writer, okay? And these people, or one of them, they really loved the writing skill of this guy, Franz Kafka. And that's the reason they named this product as Kafka, okay? And fortunately, this Kafka is all written in Java and Scala. One more reason why should you
focus a lot on Scala and Java. They are internally written using Scala and Java. You'll see all the popular tools of Apache products are written in Java and Scala, not even Python, right? Okay. The beauty is it can scale horizontally, and you can have hundreds of broker. We talked about the broker. What is that broker, guys? That broker was a server, is not it? The broker was a server. You can have hundreds of servers in a large organization, okay? And you can send million of messages per second. That's the beauty of it, okay? You can easily send millions of messages per second. It can scale. It can scale horizontally, just like your Hadoop. So, you know, like have one more broker and it will be, you know, like more powerful. Again, introduce one more broker, it will be more powerful, and so on. Now, Kafka is mainly used as a transport system, which holds your data from producer to be consumed by the consumer, right? So we have already discussed about that. Like Kafka is basically used as a transport system. It will hold your message for some time, right? Till it is not consumed by your consumer, okay? Next. Now it is very important for us to understand this publish and subscribe architecture. Okay, in this model we have three actor, sender, receiver, and broker. So as I said, who is the sender, guys? Sender, you can also call it as a producer. Okay, sender or producers are those who are actually sending the message. They're also called as publisher. Okay, receiver, who are the receivers? They are between the consumers, or they are also called as subscribers. Okay, and in the middle you have a server, which is also called as your broker. Okay, now we need to understand this particular information. Okay, we have to understand this particular information. Publisher sends a message to the broker instead of sending it directly to the receiver. As I have already told you, producer has no clue about the receivers. Producer says, I will just write the data to my broker, I don't care who is going to consume it. Okay, while sending the message, publisher classifies the message with some tag called topic, and receiver consumes the message by specifying the topic it is interested in. Broker is a central point where messages are published to facilitate this. We'll talk about this topic in some time. Okay, now this is what I was talking about, system architecture without Kafka. See how messy it is, right? So if you see this diagram, all these boxes are basically your database, like Oracle or Volumode or Expresso, right? And all these are basically applications. And if you see, this looks like a noodles, is not it? All messed up together. Okay, that's how the architecture would look like when you don't do a Kafka in between. Okay, now the same thing can be streamlined like this. See how beautiful it looks like, and very neat and clean, right? Everybody is writing to unified message log, and everybody is consuming it from those systems. Okay, that makes your Kafka better. Okay, now you may say, hey, in a single system we are writing, but let me tell you, the data would be all distributed. As I said, it is a distributed queue, so you really don't have to worry. There are hundreds of servers and it does not matter, right? At the end of the day, I call it a Kafka, but it does not mean only one system. It could be 100 different systems. It does not matter, but at the end of the day, they all come under the same. For example, when we talk about Hadoop, we don't talk about 300 nodes, right? We just say Hadoop, we just write a command, Hadoop fs-put, Hadoop fs-get, and you get the data out of it, right? So similarly, this is your Kafka system, and it really does not matter whether it is one system or whether it is 100 system. For a user like us, it is a single system. Internally, they are like 100 of systems altogether. Okay, the above process shows the simplification which is used in making a Kafka system. All right, now look into this example. You have a Kafka cluster, okay? When we say Kafka cluster, what is a cluster, guys? Cluster is a collection of more than one system. It's not it. In a real time, you will never work with one broker, mind it. You'll always have at least three brokers, you know, as per the standard, okay? But then that can go till 100 also, right? So let's say you'll have 100, let's say you have three brokers altogether in the real time, right? So we call it a cluster. All these brokers together form the cluster, right? And then this cluster can hold a lot of data from the producer. And now if you see, these are the producer, application one, application two, application three, all these are producers. They are writing the data to your Kafka cluster somehow, okay? And these are your consumers. Some applications are consuming the data from your Kafka cluster. They are called as consumer. And you can also have a connector which can connect the data from the database and read the data to your Apache cluster. And you can also have some streaming system which can stream the data, you know, to and fro the Kafka cluster. Okay, you'll get all these things very clear when we jump into the practical. Don't worry about that. So now I'll move forward and we'll talk about these terminologies, which is very, very important. Okay, I hope now we have got a little fair enough idea about the Kafka system. Now it's time for us to understand these terms, right? And I'm sure that you have already got a little familiarity with these terms. The first term is message. What is a message? Any piece of information that you are trying to send is called as a message, right? And in Kafka, it is basically an array of bytes. Okay. So in Kafka, whenever you are sending the data, they are always sent in form of array of bytes. That's something you must understand it. Okay. Producer. What is a producer? Any component that produces the message and pushes it to the broker, to your Kafka server, are called as producers. Generally, a message is produced for a specific topic. I'll talk about the topic, don't worry. Producer does not care about which data is written to which particular partitioner. I'll talk about that also. And we'll balance each partitioner evenly. However, in some case, you can direct all similar messages to a particular partition based on the key of the message. You'll get more clarity. Like, just ignore it for now. Consumer. An application that receives the data from the broker, is not it? Who can be called as a consumer? Anybody who wants to read the data from your broker are called as consumer. Okay. And one thing we need to understand is producer does not send the data directly to the consumer. Producer sends the data to broker, which will be written to a specific topic. And any consumer who is interested to receive the data from server can come forward, subscribe to that topic and get the data from the broker. Okay. All right. The consumer subscribes to one or more topic and reads the message in the order in which they were produced. So I think it's a good time for us to understand a little bit about this topic, what exactly this topic is. Okay. We'll again be going through this, document, of course, but let's jump into this concept of topics because it's very, very important. Now let's try to understand the concept of topic. Very, very simple term called topic. What is a topic? Let's see. Okay. I'll give an example which will help you to remember this forever. Okay. Say you went to an airport, right? And you want to travel from Hyderabad to Mumbai. Okay. Similarly, one more guy wants to travel from Bangalore to Mumbai. Okay. Similarly, one more guy wants to travel from Pune to Mumbai. Okay. From various different airport. So you went to Hyderabad airport and you said, I want to travel from Hyderabad to Mumbai. The other guy was in Bangalore. He said, I want to travel from Bangalore to Mumbai. The other guy said, I want to travel from Pune to Mumbai. Okay. Now, similarly, the airport where you went, you'll find a lot of people who wants to go from Hyderabad to Mumbai. You'll also see a lot of people who wants to go from Hyderabad to Pune. This is your airport because the source are same, right? Similarly, in the Bangalore airport, you'll find a lot of people who wants to travel from Bangalore to Hyderabad as well as Bangalore to Mumbai, right? In different flights, of course, and so on, right? Now, when you go for the check-in, right? So you'll give your bags, your luggage, right? And what do these guys do, guys? See, I want to understand this. How are they able to know that this bag must reach Hyderabad for Mumbai? Let's say, see, you are in Hyderabad airport and you said, this is my luggage. I want this luggage to reach to Mumbai, right? So you give them the luggage, but what makes them to identify that the luggage which you have given should reach Mumbai? What do? They paste a tag, right? They basically paste a sticker, is not it? They take a sticker and that sticker says, this guy wants to go to Mumbai, right? Destination is very, very important. Of course, they also put the source, but source is not important. Destination is important, is not it? Similarly, the other guy who also wanted to travel to Mumbai, they also get a tag. Right, this guy will get a tag called Pune. Okay, this guy will get a tag called Mumbai. This guy will get a tag
Hyderabad. This guy will get a tag, Mumbai, right? Now, because of this tag, can I say that at the end of the day, once the travel is over, these four baggage will come to my Mumbai destination, yes? So it is because of this tagging, we were able to identify that this particular bags should reach to Mumbai, okay? And in Kafka, this tagging is called as topic, nothing more than that, okay? So what is a topic, guys? Topic is basically a tag which can classify a message, okay? Which means here, a producer will produce a message. Okay, and it will be sent to whom? It will be sent to a broker. Okay, but when you are sending a message, you also have to specify a topic. And topic is basically the destination on under which tag you want this message to be stored. Okay, they are called as the destination, right? So when you say, I want to send a message, and this message is of SMS type, then what will happen within the broker? Within the broker, an array kind of structure would be created. An array kind of structure would be created, and this message would be stored here under SMS. Okay. So a topic is basically a tag. A topic is basically a tag that can help us to identify or to classify the message, the similar messages together. Okay. Now, let's take one more example to understand this. So let's say pattern. Okay, if you have used Airtel app, right, you might have seen that Airtel comes with various different features. What can you do with the Airtel app, guys? You can make your prepaid payment, you can do your postpaid payment, you can pay your electricity bill, right, you can pay your insurance bill, and so on and so on, right? Now, assume my mobile phone. This is my mobile phone, my smartphone. Assume my mobile phone with a Airtel app. Okay, I open my Airtel app, and now it's the end. It's the beginning of the month. What I want to do is I want to do some payment, right? I have my prepaid, I have my postpaid. I have to pay my electric bill. I have to pay my insurance bill. Now, what I'll do is I'll go to the prepaid section and I'll enter my number. I'll enter my number and I'll say, let me recharge with 100 rupees. I'll hit pay button. When I hit this pay button, what will happen? Message will go to the Airtel server, right? Message will go to the Airtel server and it will send your message, done, right? But let's think through, let's talk about this through Kafka approach, okay? Now, if you're doing this, then you're actually paying a prepaid amount, right? So if I say that I'm going to transmit this data to my server, can you tell me, can I call my Airtel app as producer? Yes or no? I want you to answer me. Can I call this Airtel app, my mobile phone, as a producer? Because it is producing some message, right? And the message is, in my number 90324122236, pay 100 rupees, recharge with 100 rupees, and say, I said pay, right? Now, this is my producer, and I'm producing some message. And as I said, when you are producing a message, you should basically also use a topic, okay? On which the message would go and sit under that topic. And what do you think would be the ideal topic name in this case? Prepaid, of course, right? So I'll say my tagging is prepaid. So at my Kafka server, what will happen is one array would be created. Okay, let's assume one array for now. And this array name is prepaid, the tag, right? And when I paid, that would come here. That would come here. Okay. Similarly, you may also have an Airtel, number, and you might also be interested to make a payment, prepaid payment, right? And when you do the same thing, your request will be here. And when somebody else does that, their request would be here like this. Right? And there would be a consumer would start consuming it from here. Would start consuming it from here. Okay, I'll say, okay, I've got a lot of requests for this. It looks like the money has been already debited from the bank account probably. And I'll take this, I'll consume this, I'll process this, their account, and I'll say done, right? So if you try to visualize this with Kafka, then from Kafka point of view, we have created a topic called prepaid. Okay. Similarly, next thing I would like to do is postpaid. I would like to make a payment of my postpaid number, right? I'll go to the postpaid section, I'll enter my number, and then I'll say pay 500 rupees probably. And that would go to a separate topic in the server. Okay. Similarly, electric bill. I want to pay my electric bill, and that will go to a separate topic. Right? Now see here. In case of electric bill, we all stay in different part of the country or the world, whatever. Right? So let's assume we all are staying in India, right? And now electric bill. So in my state, my department, the electricity bill department would be different than yours, right? But anyways, there would be some API integration at the end of the day, right? So when I'm trying to pay my electric bill, extra details will also go. What are those? The electric department ID number, the state, and so on, right? And the amount that the customer wants to pay, all those information would also go and would also stay here. But at the end of the day, it's just an array for me, right? So that's how your electricity bill would be paid. So when you pay, it will go to your Kafka server and will stay there, and it will be immediately processed by your consumer. There would be a lot of consumer, and you will not even see the delay. That's the biggest advantage. So you may see that it is happening in the real time, but probably under the hood, they are all implemented using Kafka. Probably. I cannot really tell you that, but then I would say probably something like this. Okay. Similarly, insurance bill. You went to the insurance bill and you say, hey, I want to pay my HDFC life insurance, and I want to pay, let's say, 10,000 rupees, click on pay button, and it'll go and sit on different topics. So at the end of the day, in the server, if you see, you have a lot of topics, right? And every topic means a classification of the message. So can I say that every message, whatever I have received under this, belongs to the prepaid only and not postpaid and not like that mixed up messages? Yes, right? So every message that you get, every information that you get in this prepaid would have a prepaid related message. Everything what you get under the postpaid will have only postpaid related message. Everything whatever you get in the electricity bill will have all the electric bill payment across the India. Again, because a lot of people are using Airtel app from various states, and everybody, you know, like many people are using Airtel app maybe to pay their electricity bill. Okay, likewise insurance bill and so on. So I hope you understood the concept of topic. What is a topic? A topic is just a tag. A topic is just an identifier, or I would say a classifier that can help you to group similar messages together. Okay. Now, similarly, let's assume I want to store all the information of my mobile phone into a Kafka server, all the information of my mobile phone. So if you talk about all the information, what are the different information you will have on your mobile phone, guys? Number one, you have SMS messages, number one. Okay. Next, you have contacts details, right? Second, you'll have call informations, right? Next, you may have the list of all the app, whatever you are using, right? And so on. Okay. Now, if you want to store all these informations of your phone, then you would create a topic like this. I would create a topic called content, where only the content details would be stored. I'll create another topic called SMS, where all my SMS messages would be stored. I'll create another topic called call logs, where all my call logs information would be stored. I called whom, when, and for how much minute I spoke to them, right? All those informations. So if you see, these are basically topic names which can classify all the messages or all the data in your mobile phone, right? Now let's assume anybody can read my WhatsApp message, for example. Then I may create another topic called WhatsApp message. And so on. Okay. So this is how the topics are related to the data. So topics are basically given to classify similar kind of data together. As we move on with the program, when we see them practically, we'll get much more better idea, and we'll see how to create the topics and all. Okay. So let's move on. Okay.
So we understood the topic concept, right? Now let's look into this. Now this would be much more easy to understand. Okay, see here. The consumer subscribes to one or more topic and reads the message in the order in which they were produced. So as we know, the producer, when they are producing the data, when they're writing the data to the broker, it will always say, I want this data to be tagged as this, right? Under a topic, right? So remember one thing, at a broker level, all the messages would be under a topic, one or other topic, okay? Now, the consumer means the people, the system who wants to read the data, they have to subscribe to those topics. For example, I'm so much interested in cricket. I'm so much interested in share markets. I'm so much interested in technology. I can subscribe to all these three topics, okay? Like, you cannot force me that I should show interest only on cricket, right? So similarly, a consumer can consume the data from various different topics. It is practically possible, okay? So the consumer subscribes to one or more topic and reads the message in the order in which they were produced. This is very important to understand. So if I say I'm a consumer and I have subscribed to a topic called cricket, then I would be able to consume all the messages that are written in the topic called cricket, okay? And I will be able to consume those data in the same order as it has received in the broker. And if you remember, in this server, if you see, we had this array, right? The data would come and stay here, right? And the data would come and stay just like in an array. And if you're a consumer, you'll consume the message one, then message two, then message three, and then message four, and so on. You'll not be consuming the message randomly, no. Whatever comes first, you'll consume that as a consumer, okay? So the consumer keeps the track of which message it has already consumed by keeping the track of offset of the message. So remember one thing, every message means one dubbier, right? One box, one array, right? One particular element of an array is basically called as one message. That holds one message. So every time your consumer is reading one message, every message will have one offset number, or you can call it, you can think about that as an index number of an array, okay? If you call this an array, then you can call these boxes can be identified by an index number, okay? In your consumer, you have a consumer here. Every time the consumer is reading the data from a topic, it will you know, like, keep a note of the index number. We call it offset. We don't call it index number, we call it offset. You keep a track of offset number that it has already read, and that will help the consumer to read the next message, because it has always a track of till what extent I have read the message, okay? That what it means. The consumer keeps track of which message it has already consumed by keeping track of offset of the message. And what is the offset? The offset is another bit of metadata, an integer value that continuously increases, that Kafka adds to each message as it is produced, okay? So what is an offset, guys? Offset is another kind of number, but it's basically an integer data, okay? It's basically an integer number which is automatically injected by the Kafka before the data reaches this cells, okay? Every cell will have one metadata, every cell will have one offset, and that offset is produced by your Kafka server before the data is written into this index, into this array, okay? So the offset is another bit of metadata, an integer value that continuously increases. So your offset increases, like it may have an offset number 0, then 1, and then 2, and then 3, and then 4, and so on. The offset will keep on increasing every time, okay? Now, yeah, so it's basically a metadata, an integer value that continuously increases, that Kafka adds to each message as it is produced. Each message in a given partition has a unique offset. And now comes a concept of partition, another important topic, but we'll again cover that up, okay? So by storing the offset of last consumed message for each partition, either in ZooKeeper or in Kafka itself, a consumer can stop and start without losing its place. Now think about this. You have a consumer here. You have a consumer here, right? Which is constantly consuming the data. And at the end of the day, what is a consumer, guys? They are also a process.
If you have written a Java client, then they are a Java process. What if the consumer is killed, right? Because of some reason. If the consumer is killed because of some reason, then the consumer will not be able to read the data from the place where it lost track, right? So what can be done is the consumer can also write the data to a zookeeper, and every time the consumer restarts, it can basically do a lookup with the zookeeper and say, can you tell me what was the last data I had read successfully? The zookeeper will give that data back to the consumer, and the consumer will understand, okay, I had read till this point, and now let me start from the next cell onwards. That can also be done. Okay, now consumer keep requesting for the data from server, and server keeps giving the data as long as it receives from the producer. So we look into this diagram. This diagram simplifies the Kafka. Okay, so you have a producer, and these producers can be many. There can be many producers like this. Okay, all these producers would write the data to a Kafka server in form of a topic, right? In form of a topic. Okay, and all the consumer would start consuming the data from the topic. Okay, so that's a high level understanding of your Kafka. Okay, now a consumer can access any data sent by any producer provided they have permission to read it. So a consumer can access any data sent by any producer. See, a consumer, all it needs to know is the topic. Okay, it has nothing to do with the producer. Producer just writes the data to server, and producer has nothing to do with consumer. Okay, it's all about the server, right? Server is holding the data. The consumer, if they have the permissions to read the data from that particular topic, it would be able to. Okay, now it is practically possible, as I said, that a particular consumer can read the data from multiple topics. For example, a single guy can have a multiple interest. I want to play guitar, my interest is in music. I play I sometime do photography, that's my interest. I sometime watch cricket, that's my interest, and so on, right? So a single consumer can read the data from many different topics altogether. Okay, now let's move on. Okay, broker. So what is a broker, guys? We have already understood the broker. The broker is nothing but it is a Kafka server, right? A Kafka server is called as a broker, which acts as a bridge between producer and consumer. We understood this, right? So the producer writes the data to a broker, and the consumer reads the data from the broker. And that's what it is. It's a mediator between producer and consumer. And producer and consumer do not interact directly. That's the important thing that you need to understand. Producer sends the data to server, and consumer reads the data from it, right? And that server is basically a broker. Okay, next. If there are multiple consumers to consume the data of a topic with multiple partitioner, then all such consumer forms a consumer group. The group assures that each partition is only consumed by one member. Now we have to understand one more topic to understand that the concept of partitions. Okay, all right. So let's look into this diagram, and then we'll go on the board. Okay, so in the below example, there are three consumers consuming four partitions. So see, look into this. If you look into this diagram, it tells you a lot of story about this. Okay, so see, the topic name is topic name, some random name. And I think I've copied this image from one of the PDF ebook of Apache Kafka. Okay, so look into this. Topic name. So it created a topic called topic name. You can give any name as topic. Okay, and this topic has four partitions. And what are those four partitions? Partitions means different areas where the data would be written. Okay, so it is possible that your topic may have a lot of data. Okay, and you really don't want to work only with one partition. You may be interested to work with different partitions altogether. And that's where the data would be all segregated. Okay, so let me go back to the screen again. So we are going to talk about what partitions. Right, now so far what we understood what is a server or a broker, what is a producer, what is a consumer. We understood that. What is a topic? We also talked about that. We understood that as well. Okay, now we have a concept called partition. Let's understand what exactly it is. Okay, so as we know that in a typical Kafka system, you have a server, you call it a broker. Okay, and you have right? So they are all producers. They're all producers, okay? And they're producing some data. They're producing some data. And as I told you, whenever the producer produces the data, they produce the data under a tag and we call it a topic, right? So let's assume all these guys are producing some data related to SMS. Related to SMS. And let's say all this, you know, contains some information about SMSs, right? So we created a topic called SMS. We created a topic called SMS. And as we say that we will be writing the data, we are actually writing the data in a topic. Okay. So producer will say, hey, I want to write this message under a topic called SMS. Tell. But the actual data would be written inside a partition. Okay. And what is the partition? Partition is actually the unit where the data gets stored. Okay. Now, it is possible. See, a typical use case, let's talk about a typical use case can be, I have created an SMS with only one partition. So only one partition means one array. Only one partition means one array. Okay. Now what will happen is if every producer is producing the data, every producer is producing the data, then those data would be going to this partition. Okay. Right. So the data would arrive in this partition. Okay. So like this is message number one, message number two, message number three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10. So whatever data is produced by these three devices, they will go and set here. Okay. They will go and set here. Okay. Now within this partition, these data are always stored in the order they are arrived, which means at 9 o'clock, if I have produced one message, that will go here. At 9:10, that would come here. At 9:15, that would come here. At 9:16, that would come here. Okay. At 9:17, that would come here. Okay. Likewise. So the message that was produced first will be here. The message that was produced next would be here, and so on. So this always has a recent data. This will always have the oldest data. That's how the data would be stored in terms of in form of partitions. Okay. Now it is not a great idea to just work with only one partition, because if you work with only one partition, don't you think you're going to make this a very heavy? Yes, of course. Right. Because your data, all your data is getting stored in a single array. It's not it, a single array kind of stuff. So this will make your broker very, very heavy. So it is not advised that you just work with only one partition. No, never do that. Try to have multiple partitions. And why do you need multiple partitions? So that the data can be evenly distributed as much as possible. Okay. So what I may do is I may say, okay, what I'll do is let me create three partitions. And if I create three partitions, then I'll have P0, I'll have P1, I'll have P2. Okay. So I'll have three partitions. And once we start sending the data, some of the data would go here. Some of the data would go here. Some of the data would go here based on some conditions. Okay. And we can control that conditions totally. Okay. We can definitely say, hey, I want this data to go only to partition zero. I want this data to go to only partition one. I want this data to go to only partition two. That can be completely controlled, and we'll see that in practical class, of course. Okay. So if you have three partitions, then the advantage would be the data would be distributed instead of getting stored in a single system, right? Instead of getting stored in a single partition, the data would be distributed. Done. Next, now in a typical real time, see, this is only one server, right? In a typical real time, what you could have is you could have three broker. And if you have three broker, it is practically possible that P0 is here and P1 is here. And P2 is here. It's practically possible that P0 is here, P1 is not here, P2 is not here, and they are all here. Okay. Now, do you get a feeling that yes, if I have multiple partition, then my load will be distributed because I have multiple systems now, right? So P0 would store the data here, P1 would store the data here, and P2 would store the data here. So we have divided our data into multiple machines altogether because of this partition concept. Okay. So these partitions are the actual data storage unit. Okay. So the data are not stored in topics, I'll tell you, right? So see, when you are producing the data from the producer will actually by default says, I want this data to be stored on this topic, that's it, okay? But then the data would actually come and eventually get stored in your partitions, okay? The partitions are just like your blocks in Hadoop, right? We always say Hadoop fs-put, and we don't care where the data is going and getting stored, but the data are actually going and getting stored in form of blocks. And those blocks are divided across machines altogether, is not it? So likewise, your P0 is one, is here, P1 is here, and P2 is here, and they all store data in one another form. That's what the partition does, okay? So the partition is basically the physical unit where the data gets stored, okay? Now let's move on. Let's look into this diagram, okay? So if you see this diagram, in this diagram, what we have assumed is, we have assumed that we have a single broker, okay? We have assumed that we have a single broker, and while creating the topic, I give some name like topic name or default name, and then we have created the data, we have stored the data in form in different partitions. So here the total partitions are 4, P0, P1, P2 and P3, okay? Now if you see 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, all these are offset numbers, okay? These are all just offset numbers. And again, partition one, they have offset numbers. Again, partition two, they have offset numbers, and so on. Okay. Now if you look into this example, in this example, you can see is you have a consumer group. So you can also create a consumer group wherein you will say, I have 3-4 consumers who will actually read the data from a particular topic. And as I told you, I'll be doing all these things practically. I'll be showing you this so that you understand what we are exactly talking about. We'll recap this, okay, when we do the practical stuff, okay? See here, you have one topic called topic name, and you have 4 partitions, okay? And let's assume all these boxes, right, where the numbers are written 0 to 13, 0 to 9, 0 to 11, 0 to 12. Let's say all these are actually messages, some form of message, right? Now, can you tell me how many messages are there right now? See here, 0 to 13, 14 messages. 10, 14 plus 10 is 24. 24 and 12. 24 and 12 is 36. Okay, 36 and 13. 36, 46, 47, 48, 49. So can I say all together right now, what I see on the screen, I have 49 messages, right? As per the diagram, what we see. All these 49 messages are stored across partition 0, partition 1, partition 2, and partition 3. Again, now you have a choice. You can say, I want to write only one consumer and let that consumer read the entire data from all these partitions. Okay, in that case, that consumer will have to read all these 49 messages and process. Okay, which will be definitely a time taking process, of course, because a single guy has to work, right? And if you want to make your process much more faster, then you should introduce multiple consumer. You can say, hey, I want more consumer to consume all this data. And if you see this case talks about that. You have a consumer group where you have consumer 0, consumer 1, and consumer 2. And if you look into the diagram says, let the consumer 0 read the data from partition 0. Okay. Let the consumer 1 consume the data of 1 and 2. See this, 1 and 2. Okay, let the consumer 2 read the data from partition 3. And why did we do that? Probably because the first partition is so big, and I wanted only one consumer to read the data, of course. The partition 1 and 2 are moderate, right? So we said, okay, let us introduce consumer 1 that can read the data from both these partitions 1 and 2. And finally, consumer 2, let this consumer 2 read the data from partition 3. Okay, now look into this. In the below example, there are 3 consumers, right? Yes, there are 3 consumers consuming 4 partitions. They are consuming the data from 4 different partitions. Consumer 1 is consuming partition 1 and partition 2 data together. So this is a consumer 1, which is consuming partition 1 and partition 2 data together. In this way, the consumer can also be scaled up as the partitions are getting scaled up. So
you can have many number of partitions, you can have many number of consumers, you can have many number of producers, right? So at the end of the day, what should be your target? Your target should be try to introduce as many consumers as you can so that the data is processed as soon as possible. If you have only one consumer, then this single guy will have to consume all these 49 messages and it might take little time, right? But if you have more consumers, then more consumer can process all this data. Now, this is also an important thing which you should understand now. If there are multiple consumers to consume the data of a topic with multiple partitioners, this is what we are talking about, okay? See here. If there are multiple consumer, we have multiple consumer, yes, right? We have a multiple consumer in this case. Consumer 0, consumer 1, consumer 2. We have multiple consumer who wants to consume the data of a topic with multiple partitions. You have multiple partitions here also. Then all such consumer forms a consumer group. So all these consumers formed a group called consumer group because the target of all these consumers are to consume the data from a single partition, single topic. Okay. And of course, the data is distributed across multiple partitions. Again, the group assures that each partition is consumed by one member. So see here, it should never happen that little message of this partition one is consumed by consumer one and little message is consumed by consumer two. That will never ever happen. Okay. So what I'm trying to tell you is it is possible that one consumer can read the data from multiple partition, but it is not possible that one partitioner would be consumed parallelly by different consumers. Okay, that is not allowed in Kafka. So Kafka cluster is a set of node where each node is executing one instance of Kafka broker. So when I say I have a Kafka cluster, that means I have a multiple node, probably 3 nodes, 5 nodes, 10 nodes. And in all these nodes, Kafka servers are running, right? Which has the capability to host the topic, which has the capability to create the partitions, which have the capability to store the data in partitions. And this is how it looks like. Producer sends message. And if you see, this is a Kafka cluster where you have a server one, server two, server three, you call it them broker. And all those server details are managed by Zookeeper and the consumer requests for the message and the consumer gets the message from the Kafka cluster. Now, for a consumer, what is important is the topic. Okay, the consumer will not say I want to read the data only from broker 2, right? So the consumer will have to say I want to read the data belonging to SMS topic, and this Kafka cluster would serve all the messages from Kafka, from that particular topic back to that consumer.